Good morning. I feel a little bit like I'm following Bill Clinton. Plus, Ozzy told me that I had about 4.5 minutes, and I reminded him that my father, when posed the same question, would say, "I can't clear my throat in 4.5 minutes, so bear with me. Thank you. First, I would love to give the Modell family thanks to Rabbi Bush, Cantor Solomon, and Baltimore Hebrew for honoring my father today. Y'all almost got me. I've been crying so much I need Gatorade. I'm going to cramp up. So, Cantor Solomon, your song was special, and I will remember that forever. Thanks to Roger Goodell for his heartfelt words. There is protocol, of course. If the commissioner is here, he should speak. Roger was sweet and kind enough to say to us that he didn't need to speak. He just wanted to be here to honor my father. But I knew how much my father meant to Roger, and today would have been incomplete without your sharing. And to my younger brother, Ray, I wish I could put pads on and play alongside you. You are a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful man who my father genuinely loved dearly. And you've returned that in kind. And so for you, I have a bottle of Tiffany for men. Because that's what it was. We couldn't possibly have dealt with these past few tumultuous days without the kindness of the Ravens organization. This may happen a few times, so pardon me. For their just incredible support and kindness. And I believe that support and kindness is an exemplification of Steve Bisciotti, who is yet another brother that my father adopted into the family. I have lots of brothers, and I'm proud of this one. When Poppy was in the last throes, I called Steve, and Steve came down to the hospital and sat with me all day long until my brother arrived. He wouldn't leave me alone until my brother arrived. In the midst of the day, John Harbaugh, fresh off the practice field, with Ray and Ed and Haloti and T-Sizz, came down to visit Poppy and hear these larger-than-life athletes, these men who defend the flag of Baltimore and the flag of the Ravens, were on their knees praying with my father at his bedside with tears streaming down their faces. Perhaps one of the most powerful moments. And for that, we were very grateful. And of course, we're extraordinarily grateful for winning last night. Can't go on without thanking individuals without whom both of my parents would have not been able to go on, really. During both of their illness, they had a number of what I refer to as angels, these sweet, kind, caring women sitting here, Joan and Karen, Tess and Carmen, Blessing and Helen, Reza, Nina, Margie, Jackie, and Linda. You all are angels walking among us. You touched my parents in such a sweet way. You were so kind to them. They never had a want. And the end of their lives were blessed because of your kindness and thoughtfulness. And we will never, ever forget you as long as we live. Thank you. Naturally, there are two I have to single out. I don't know where Jim is, but I have to see Jim. Jim Wolfe and Guilan Liu, who were with my parents every day for many, many, many years. Their incredible devotion to my parents, and again, kindness, and humor that they constantly brought. They fit in very well. Whenever my father needed Gui, he would just yell, Gui! And from across the house, she was like a sprinter. If you timed her, she'd be under sub 440. She'd come ripping through the house. You hear that? Gui would take care of everything my father needed. You guys are wonderful, and we appreciate it. And lastly, thanks to Sam Miller for her incredible years of devotion. Sam received a paycheck because she worked for art, but I don't think Sam really needed the paycheck because she loved art. And her husband, Carl, who last year, when you bent over at the football game and kissed my father on the cheek, oh my. Big tough guy. Yeah, very sweet. And Sam and Michelle, who, as you can imagine, with loads of details, Sam and Michelle tucked it all up. It was game day for them. They took care of business. Everything that's happened, everything that's going on, everyone that's here, they've touched all of us. They have done a beautiful job, and I appreciate that very much. And to Michelle, so my father, I'm Catholic, sorry. They say there are lightning bolts in churches, I don't know about here, but. And so Poppy would call me the Goy, which I loved, because I am. So I would call and he'd go, how's my favorite Goy doing today? And so with Michelle, I finally had to say to him, well, Michelle needs a nickname too. She can't get away without a nickname. And so we settled on the Goyette. Michelle is the Goyette. And once we settled on that about a year and a half ago, that became her name. And he would call the house and say, is the Goyette there? The two of them developed a love affair that was incredibly sweet. Trust me, after 30-some-odd years of being with me almost every day, he was sick of hearing from me. But he loved hearing from you. And I believe that with others, you guys helped my father stay alive longer than he might have otherwise. Very sweet. Very sweet, both of you. Thank you. This will be a continuation of my love letter to my mother. Dear Patty, I think about you and miss you every day. I hear your voice in my head all the time. And even though I still hear, oh, shut up, David, from time to time, I always smile. Sometimes I cry. A year ago, I wrote you what I now know was only part of a love letter. Today, I'm writing you the second, but I'm sure not the last installment. Share it with Poppy if you get a chance. Thank you so much for bringing Big Poppy into my life. What you did not realize at the time was that you were giving me a wonderful father, a dear friend, and my one true hero. I'm sure that you were aghast when the very first thing he did was teach my brother John and I the proper way to light matches. Or the first time he brought us to a toy store and characteristically filled the car with toys, slightly divergent from your one toy philosophy. Heck, we thought this guy was great. Little did he realize the tumult we would occasionally create in his life. Little did we all realize just how much he would teach us about our own lives. Little did I realize as a child the depth of love that I would feel for you both. Patty, as you know, he had so many great accomplishments in his life. It would be easy to claim he was my hero on the basis of those alone. But you also know, you who knew him better than any of us, that Poppy's greatest attributes, his kindness, his sense of humor, his gentlemanliness, his respect for others, were best exemplified in the smaller, quieter moments and were forged early in his exemplary life. You know how much he loved and admired his father, George. What a privilege that he shared his recollections and his devotion to his father with us all often. A consummate gentleman, kind as well, always well dressed with spats, willing to do what it took to support his family in the throes of the Depression. My grandfather's death was devastating to Poppy. But it is clear to me that George's death and his remembrance were fuel. He idolized his pal George, and I believe lived a life aimed at making his father proud. The struggle of losing his father and then being the man of the family, supporting his loving mother Kitty and his sisters Pansy and Selma, became his focus and his crucible. From the depths of a ship's hold as an electrician's helper in the Brooklyn shipyard as a 14-year-old boy, to a soldier working two night jobs, to an innovator in early television, to an original madman in advertising, to an NFL legend. Our Poppy's accomplishments have made George proud. But if George was anything like Poppy, like we suspect, he would have been prouder, not of what Poppy accomplished, but how he did it, and would have been proudest that Poppy passed these core values along to his boys, not only in his words, but in his deeds. Patty, do you remember Poppy's story about how the gruff Irish executive demanded that Poppy remove those newfangled contraptions known as TVs from his store shelves, only to learn after that same gruff man had pulled a subordinate aside and said, "Don't let the kid get hurt. It made such an impression on young Art." Or when Bob the gardener from the Arizona Biltmore Hotel, and Poppy had befriended, because Poppy was just a regular guy and would literally talk to and befriend everyone. Bob the gardener showed up one day at Poppy's office and asked for help. Poppy, as you all know, of course helped. When I, as a wizened old man of 13, suggested that Poppy would never see Bob or his loan ever again, Poppy said, "I know, but you have to remember that I understand hard times." Or when he not only suggested that the Baltimore Police Department motormen who had escorted you guys to an event get some food, he brought them into the kitchen and made sure that they were fed. or that he would never, ever ride in the back seat of a driven car because he didn't want the driver to feel awkward. His name may be on buildings, but it is also etched on the hearts of those whose lives he quietly touched. Patty, you would have been proud as heck of Poppy this past year. The consistency of Poppy's kindness was unfathomable, wasn't it, ladies? Even in his time of need, in his time of physical difficulty, in his time of unconsolable grief, Poppy was always the gentleman you loved. Always a smile, always a thank you, even to the person who came into his room in the middle of the night to draw blood, woke him up, drew the blood. Poppy looks at him and says, thank you. No matter how he felt when Michelle and I or others would visit to comfort him, Poppy, always the gentleman, was our host and was comforting us. Patty, heaven must be lovely in so many ways. Or at least it is now after you've helped to redecorate it. But as wonderful as it must be, I'm guessing St. Peter and the Blessed Mother will also welcome Poppy's sense of humor. As many others from his generation living in the melting pot of New York had to do, they relied on humor to get them through dark days. But very few had the sense of humor that Poppy possessed. He used it as a tool to delight us, and for those who experienced that, to delight himself. He laughed harder at his own jokes, and sometimes the jokes weren't funny, and we laughed hard with him because he laughed so hard. But he also used it as a tool to help himself to cope and help others to cope. In his tough times, he helped himself with humor, and he made those around him feel better. But mostly, I just liked laughing with him. You gave me a wonderful photo of Poppy and me on a podium at some event, honoring Poppy, and he and I are both laughing. Truth be told, laughing because, like two schoolboys in the back of the class, I had whispered one of his favorite punchlines into his ear, and we were both laughing hysterically at a moment when it might have been better not to. I will love and cherish this image. And you would have laughed with him and us when, on our Florida trip last March, Poppy asked his nurse, sweet Josephine, to rub his foot, which was my father's single greatest pleasure. So the deer began rubbing the top of Poppy's foot gently, and Poppy said, no, Josephine, below the toe. Josephine did not fully understand and started blowing on his big toe. He thought it was hysterical. We laughed and we laughed and we laughed. And of course, he was up to his old tricks at the hospital last week, too. Patty, you know the one-liners. When asked if he was comfortable, he said he made a living. When asked how he slept, he said, like a baby, woke up every 2 hours crying. Or when asked how do you feel, he said, I feel like a 20-year-old. Where do you find one at this hour? Actually, Poppy said that to his sweet Dr. Ira Fine and I the evening that he had a stroke. Ira came out, told my father he had a stroke, and my father said, uncharacteristically, hit his chest. And it was just a beat. There's a couple of beats. And Ira said, Poppy, how do you feel? And he looked up and he said, like a 20-year-old. Do you know where I can find one? And Ira and I looked at each other, and we thought, Poppy's okay. Because his humor was intact. And Patty, you know how much I love to josh you both about our vast political differences. Well, on Poppy's last night with us, I was holding his hand, loving, holding his hand. And I told him how much I loved holding his hand, and like with you, how I wished I hadn't waited so long. But then, as was our relationship, naturally I had to try to make him laugh. So I told him, "See, Poppy, grown men holding hands isn't so bad." He knew exactly where I was going with that, and we laughed. And it was our last communication in this world. A laugh. It's beautiful. And of course, Patty, there was you. Babe. The kid. Kismet delivered to you both the perfect companion. Not only devoted husband and wife, but partners on a wild adventure together. He must have loved beyond words that you not only laughed at all of his jokes every single time, but that you gave as good as you got. I'll never forget how you teased him at the huge Timmy dinner in Washington. Remember how he wanted to leave, and he was gesticulating wildly from the podium. And you told us all at the table, just put your heads down and pretend you don't see him. You shared his sense of humor to a T. He must have loved beyond words how you just jumped in and became his football life, going to all the awards banquets, traveling with him on the team plane to every away game, and loving his passion like it was yours until it was. He must have loved how you stood by him without reservation at each twist and turn and difficulty, and he was comforted by your steady presence and unrelenting prayers during each of his far too many physical setbacks. He loved you, Patty, so deeply, and spoke to us of you every single day. To borrow from Peter Gabriel San Jacinto, you were that line of strength that pulled him through the fear. And he held on to that line as it stretched to heaven. He never let go because it made him feel closer to you in your absence. He never let go because even from afar, you continued to give him strength to face his challenges. He never let go because he knew that line would soon lead back to you. Lastly for now, Patty, thanks for helping with the weather last Saturday. We appreciate it. Remember how much you loved it when Poppy was greeted by 100 fans when he arrived at the stadium on game day? Well, you would have been just beside yourself to see what happened the other day at the public memorial at the stadium. It was a personification of everything Poppy was. He used to tell us why he thought pro sports teams were so important to a community, that they served as glue to bring together folks from disparate walks of life in support of a common cause. And his hope was that that day of commonality would spread to more days of the week. Well, there it was. 5,000 fans descended on the stadium to pay their respects to Poppy. There were bank presidents and church ladies, both in Ravens jerseys. There were all hues and religions. There were fathers and sons and grandmothers and granddaughters. There was joy, there were thanks, and there were tears. There was kindness and warmth from complete strangers. It was peaceful and celebratory and loving. It was one of the most astonishing things I have ever witnessed. And it was all for your Poppy. Well, he really loved Baltimore, and Baltimore loves Art Modell. Sweetheart, I am so happy for you because there is no doubt in my mind, and there should be no doubt in any of our minds, that you and Poppy are together again. Gone is any worry and strife. Gone is any physical pain or limitation. All you have now is your love and laughter into eternity. I love you both dearly. I miss you more than you both will ever know. And I'll see you on the other side. God bless you. God bless everyone here.